Bible referred to all of the faithful gathered. It wasn't those people who were venerated as saints by the church, but the whole fellowship gathered. And then over time, as the church depended on those examples, those exemplars of the faith, those martyrs who were willing to die for the faith to help carry the church, they started to exalt those folks that had exemplary lives, whether they were martyred or just an example of living without fear and carrying the gospel into the world. We started to venerate them, and then all of a sudden saints came to be the people that end up in the stained glass windows. And as the few centuries went by, we realized that we needed to have an occasion to acknowledge all of the faithful, the people that helped carry us in our journey, the people that we remember as the saints in our own lives. And so we had All Souls Day, which was the next day. So November 1st was All Saints, and November 2nd was All Souls. And then during the Reformation, if you remember some of the events going on at the time where indulgences were sold and people were more suspicious of who we called that heavenly elect, it sort of fell out of favor. And then in our tradition, in the Anglican tradition, after World War I, we were kind of at a loss. How do we deal with the loss? What theology or what is in place to help us deal with the fact that at our dinner tables there's empty chairs? The fact that so many people lost loved ones, that death touched so close to home for so many. How do we have room to acknowledge that loss? And so we started to celebrate again on that November 2nd, All Faithful Departed. And so I believe here on All Saints Sunday, we celebrate not just the people who are adorned in the stained glass windows or the names of those saints in St. James' story that are often on the placards below, but all of the folks that may be responsible for you sitting in the pew today, all of the folks that have been part of your journey of faith, that have carried St. James through the last 200 years, that maybe as you think about your journey, the people that have been there along the way, your Sunday school teachers, that person who you always said, that person, I want to grow up to be the kind of Christian that person is. And maybe it's the people that you still feel the presence of as you gather at the Eucharistic table. Those that I see as I look back just in my few years here, my 4 years here, I can tell you that there are folks that I still feel in the midst of us. So I asked you to get a little less concrete and a little bit more mystical today, and really look for the people that are there in our midst, in our theological understanding, in our mysterial understanding of the fact, our mystical understanding of the fact that when we gather for communion, it's not just those gathered here on this November 6, 2016 at 10:15, or those that gathered at 8, or those gathering for Eucharist all around the globe at this moment in time, but that mystical understanding that this foretaste of that heavenly banquet includes all of the body. All of the body of Christ. And when we think about all of the body of Christ, we think about the church triumphant, who are all those people whose work is already done, who've lived a faithful life, who are spending the rest of eternity at that banquet table, who already are drinking deeply and eating richly from that fine food promised us at that banquet table. And beyond that, we also celebrate that the body of Christ is the church militant. What we mean by that is the church working valiantly, the church working fully in the moment. Us, all of us gathered around the globe that are in our time building up the kingdom of God. Church working vociferously to fulfill the gospel promise, to feed the hungry, to clothe the cold, to provide shelter for the under-sheltered, to visit the imprisoned, to be with those that weep. The body of Christ living in the world, the hands and feet of God today in the world, the church. We also gather with the church expectant. Not that just these two wonderful girls who will be baptized into the church today, but all of those who will be part of the story in centuries to come. It's a beautiful image that in some mystical way, between the shoulders that we see or feel beside us, there are saints aplenty. There are saints that are yet to be born. There are saints that touched our lives. And I invite you on this day to think about those saints that you remember, those people that are help supporting you as you walk up to that that banquet table, those people who've been part of your journey. I also invite you to think of the gospel for today. This is Luke's telling of the Sermon on the Mount. And when Luke tells the story, he's changing some of the details. And I don't think it's just because he disagreed with Matthew about the geography of where it took place. I think we have to understand that Luke was intimately concerned with what the church is doing today in the now. And that this Sermon on the Mount wasn't just consolation for those who were hungry or poor or didn't get their just desserts in this life, that they would have consolation in heaven. It is about the mission of the church and about what it is to have God coming in the flesh. And so Luke has us not with Jesus up on top of a mountain, but Jesus on a level place. Because the incarnation is not that God came almost all the way down, but that God came all the way down. That God became fully human, so much so that he is looking up at his disciples when he tells them this incredible sermon. And it's not just the poor in spirit. It's the physical poor. And it's about our work now. And Luke means it. Luke cuts straight to the core. You are the body of Christ. You are the church. You who are rich, be generous now because you won't get it in heaven. This is your moment. You who are hungry, you need to be fed now, not just with some heavenly consolation that's down the road. This is about the mission and the work of the church today. This is what sainthood is. This is what the church militant is charged with doing, is to feed the hungry, bless you, to clothe the poor, to be God's hands and feet in the world now. To be valiant, to be vigorous in working the gospel. And that's our charge, to participate with those whose shoulders we stand upon, those who may have been the reason that we're in the pews today. And one of the things that I did as I was preparing for today is I read through countless numbers of Richard's beautiful essays. And I invite you to do the same. You go on the website, and at one point we're gonna collate all of them. But all of those essays about the last 200 years in the church, and looking for the examples of saints. And it's fascinating. The fact that we were a continuous place of worship for both sides during the Civil War, the incredible courage and commitment of those who started the church in 1730 or started St. James in 1816, the people that committed to building the expansion, not just that, the ministry that took place, a school for handicapped children that existed at one point in time in the late 60s, early 70s, the incredible work that if you read these essays, you realize that we've been involved in ministries serving so many, being a light to so many people. And you also realize the places where maybe we fell short. You know, we had some remarkable stories of things that that the church did do during slavery, liturgies and rites performed for enslaved and free black people. But you also see places we fell short as we tried to be the body of Christ. But what all of a sudden occurred to me is that the saints that probably got marked in a lot of these essays, the saints that may get marked in the essays when they talk about the church 100 years from now, about what the church was like at 200 years old, many of the names of the saints that I think of might not be in the text there. The people who showed up with a casserole, the people who showed up at the hospital, or who called the person who they hadn't seen for a few weeks and made sure that they dropped off at church or they picked up on the way to church. The people who invest in the young children around here and ask their name and thank them for acolyting or serving in some way. The people who've rolled up their sleeves and served week after week at the food pantry or at the free clinic. The people who quietly go about making sure that the altar is set and that the Lord's meal is shared. And that the people that tell people about their church and invite them. The people that may not realize that they have been a saint in someone's life, that they have been that connection to God. I think about all of them and how through history we participated with a litany of saints, with a litany of people whose lives have been charged. So I invite you, as you come forward Sunday, but especially on this Sunday, to remember at this banquet prepared so lovingly by God that there are so many people we don't see. So many people that sit next to us every Sunday invisibly in that mystical way that gather shoulder to shoulder with us at the table. Remember those saints in your life. And remember your responsibility to the church expected. The church yet to come. What stories will